Sì.
Clap your hands. Thank you.
pray. Check, check, check. Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on and clap your hands. Come on, come on, come on. You can do better than that. Come on, open up your mouth. Come on, come on. Just open up your mouth and tell God thank you. Come on, come on. You can do better than that. I said open up your mouth and tell God thank you. Come on, come on, come on, come on. I said open up your mouth and tell him thank you. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank you for dying just to save us. Come on, one more time. Just give God your best praise. I can't hear you. Not for me. Give that for Jesus. Open up your mouth and give him glory. Hallelujah. Open up your mouth and give him glory. Hallelujah. Hosanna. Hallelujah. Come on, just stand up on your feet as we go high into worship. Anybody come to lift that name, Jesus, today? Hallelujah. 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 Come on, Hosanna. Come on, somebody shout that name, Hosanna. I said, somebody shout that name, Hosanna.
Hosanna.
One more time, shout that name, Hosanna. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. We exalt Thee. We exalt Thee. We exalt Thee. Oh, Lord. Can we just concentrate on Him? We exalt Thee. We exalt Thee. We exalt Thee. Oh, Lord. Come on, everybody, say, we exalt Thee.
We exalt Thee.
Come on. We exalt Thee. Come on, will you lift your voice? We exalt Thee.
We exalt.
Come on.
Thee.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, Lord.
Thank you for dying for me. We exalt Thee. Hey.
We
lift you up. We magnify your name. Oh, Lord. Come on, will you just stand up on your feet and say, we exalt Thee. Hey, there's nobody like you, God. Yeah. We exalt Thee. Oh, Lord. Come on, everybody lift your voice. For healing me. Oh, Lord. Now come on and give God your best praise. Come on, open up your mouth and give him glory. Hallelujah, Hosanna. Hallelujah, Hosanna. Hallelujah. Y'all stand up on your feet. Y'all stand up on your feet. Come on, get up on your feet.
Hosanna, Jesus went to Calvary to save you.
say, Hosanna,
hey.
Thank you for dying for me,
Hosanna.
Thank you for your life that you shed for me. Y'all feel like dancing. Y'all feel like dancing with me. Here we go. Here we go. Oh, hey. To the right. To the right. To the right. To the right. To the left. To the left. Hey. To the left. To the left. Hosanna. Hey. Hosanna. Can y'all do it with me? Everybody. Hey, hey, hey. To the left. To the left. You love him. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Just fill this room with worship. Come on, come on, come on. Some Lord, I love you. Come on, some Lord, I thank you. Come on, come on, come on. Let him hear you. Come on, let heaven hear you. Come on. Bread of heaven, send down from glory. Many things you were on earth
a holy king, a carpenter. You are the living word, bread of heaven, sent down from glory. Many things you were, oh, not a holy king, a carpenter. You are the living word. Come on, worship him right there. Come on, just open up your mouth and think of his goodness. Come on. Lord, we thank you. Come on. Lord, we love you. Hallelujah. Many things you were on earth, a holy king, a carpenter. Come on. Everybody say, bread of heaven.
Bread of heaven.
Come on, send down from glory. Hey. Many, 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 many things.
Many things you were.
A holy king.
A
carpenter.
King.
You are the living word.
Say,
bread of heaven. Send down from glory. Many, many things you were.
Hey.
A holy king. Carpenter, come on, you are the living word. Say, awesome ruler, come on, since our Redeemer. Oh, come on, what a breath we have. Come on, you are the living word. Say, oh. What we call you,
that's what we call you.
Major born, hey,
major born, but on
you died,
you died
to save humanity. Come on, will you just open your mouth and give them glory?
You are the living Jesus.
That's what we call you,
that's what we call you.
Major born. But on the tree
you died
to
say
that
you are the living word.
Jesus, that's what we call you.
Jesus.
Woo. I said open up your mouth. Come on, come on, come on. The Bible says let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So open up your mouth and give them glory. Come on, tell them thank you. Come on, tell them we love you. We couldn't make it without your grace. We couldn't make it without your mercy. If it wasn't for you, God, I don't know where I would be. Oh, hey, say Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus.
Say Jesus, Jesus. Hey.
Jesus, Jesus.
There's power in the name of Jesus.
Jesus,
hey.
Jesus.
There is healing in the name of Jesus.
Jesus.
You can find peace in the name of Jesus.
Jesus, hey. Jesus.
I love him. Yes,
Jesus,
I do.
Jesus,
hey. I love him. Yes,
Jesus,
I do. I love Jesus.
Jesus,
everybody shout Jesus.
Is the living word on today. Oh, come on and open up your mouth and love on Jesus. Come on right there. Come on and just begin to tell him how grateful you are, how thankful you are on this resurrection Sunday. Oh my God, hallelujah. As I saw, amen, my grandbabies, three of them up here flagging. Ain't nobody else got to say nothing on today. I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and with all that is within me. Because I understand this morning, it could have been otherwise. They could be somewhere else. But to God be the glory. Father, I thank you on today, on this Resurrection Sunday. Oh, come on and bless God in the mighty name of Jesus. Come on and love on him. Amen. And to all of you, I come to greet you in the mighty name of Jesus. Twin, can't you see your baby flagging already? Come on in the name of Jesus. It got to be a mother in here with vision right now. If I see them doing it, surely mine can do it on this morning. Come on in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, somebody got to have vision for your children. You got to have vision for your grandchildren. Come on in the name of Jesus. And then we surely want to honor Sister Bridget and Gap. Amen. This morning. Amen. For allowing our children to be a part of Resurrection Sunday. Hallelujah. If we could ask all of our.
We got a special order of service this morning. You're doing a great job, but let's vote the floor because they got to do multiple things. Stay behind. Let the kids do their thing. Let's give God praise for Gap. Let's give God praise for G-Force. Give God praise for Pastor Sandra. She was doing her job, but they want a little. Y'all ready? At this point, we're supposed to have the welcome song. Y'all got to pay on, y'all stay on point. When I send correspondence out, it's not for me just to be having to do. Stay on point. It's time for the business song. Let's go. Let's go. Let's pray. Business song. Let's go. Stay on track. Stay on point. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Apple-yo, apple-yo, apple-yo. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Stand on your feet this morning.
Hey, come on. Let me see you cup your hands. Hey. Ooh. Everybody clap your hands, hey, hey, hey. Everybody clap your hands, hey. Here we go, y'all ready? Yeah.
Come on, y'all can do better than that. These are our children. Give God praise. Come on, come on. Everybody on your feet. Give these children a standing ovation even before they go. Give them a standing ovation. Let your children know on Resurrection Sunday you love them, you appreciate them. Come on, give them praise. Give them. If they're not your children, give somebody else children, grandchildren, godchildren, children from the community, our family, our generation, our next. Come on, give God praise for all the workers, all the leaders of G-Force who loving our children, teaching our children, motivating our children, and loving them. Come on, give God praise on this Resurrection Sunday.
Taken the Lord away, and I don't know where they have put him.
Simon Peter, John, and some other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but John outran Simon Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate. Finally, John, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed, but they still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. The disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They spoke to her. At this, Mary turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize yet that it was Jesus. She thought perhaps the man she saw was the gardener.
If you have taken my Lord away, just tell me where I have put him and I'll get him. Seen the Lord.
And she told him all the things that he said to her. Now Jesus' friends did not have to be sad anymore. Now they know that Jesus was alive forever.
Happy Easter.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Great job, kids. Great job, G-Force children. Great, great, great job. Now, if you are a parent, a grandparent, a godmother, a aunt, uncle, make sure you get your children to G-Force Ministry. They are training our children, loving our children, spiritually educating our children. If you want your children to be ministered to in an atmosphere that's safe and conducive for their growth, get them to G-Force Children's Church every Sunday. We have children 12 and under having their own worship experience in their own flavor and their own style. One more time, give God praise for all who work with them. I'll do it later on sit down, but I want to give a special praise to Sherelle. She has stood up to the test and doing an excellent job. Take your seats just for a second. Co-pastor, come back up with me real quick. Let's get back on point. We got a lot going on today. Thank you for being patient with the process. I want to do something real quickly. If you receive one of these cards, the first 50 adults that came in, you got a card this morning and put your name on it. If I have your name up here, please stand. If you were the first 50 in service and you filled out one of these white cards, please stand. Please stand. Sister Trina, what I want to do is I want to give them you these cards. Go to those boxes. We have 50 boxes of groceries over here, and everybody who came in early, it's a benefit of coming in early. The first 50 adults who came in early, I want you to put your name either on a box. If you don't need the groceries, then give to somebody either in service or in your family, your neighborhood, that need a box of groceries. On Resurrection Sunday, we want to bless somebody with a box of groceries. So the first 50, you can either take the box of groceries or give it away to somebody. Come and get these cards. And make sure only those that came early, on time. It's a blessing to being on time to a worship service. So you either keep your box of groceries for yourself if you need it, or spread the love of Christ to someone else. Come on, give God praise on Resurrection Sunday. So, Pastor, again, thank you, thank you, thank you. Won't you greet our guests and our visitors at this time?
Amen. Good morning again, everyone. If we could get all of our first-time guests to stand on your feet. If you are a first-time guest, why don't you stand on your feet? We just want to welcome you into the greenhouse. Thank y'all for being here on today. Thank you for being here. You could have chose anywhere else to go and worship God on this Resurrection Sunday. Come on, greenhouse. Can we do better than that? Can we welcome them into the greenhouse, the place you go to grow, to reach your full potential? And because you our first time guests here, we want to love on you. If this is your first time viewing online, can we welcome you into the Greenhouse International Church? Those of you that are first time guests, immediately after service, if you would proceed over to the next table, and if there's anything on the table that you desire, because you are a first-time guest, we just want to bless you. That's just our way of telling you thank you for being here at the Greenhouse International Church. Now, if you had visitors on this morning, you took out the time to invite somebody else, can you stand on your feet this morning? We just want to tell you thank you for being an inviter. Thank you for being an inviter. Amen, Sister Alicia, this morning. Amen. She did the hand of the champion. come on and make some noise. If you take out the time and you invite somebody else to come, we should honor you, because it takes all of us, amen, to grow this church to the next level. Those of you that give, those of you that invite, we thank God for you on this morning. Come on and make some noise for everyone that invited somebody. And because you invited somebody, you get to proceed over to the table too. And if you don't want the gift, you can give it off to someone else this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Now, can you just give God one more resurrection thunderous praise in Him?
Now,
hallelujah.
We were so blessed on yesterday after we had our G-Men's breakfast from 10 to 12, then co-pastor and I, Pastor Jose, our Spanish pastor, and some of the faithful members both in the Spanish church and in our service went out on North Rural
Amen.
In the community.
Thank y'all.
When we first got here, we made a statement that we were going to transform North Rural and use the example of North Rural to transform North Harris, Greater Houston, the state of Texas, and United States of America. So put those pictures up real quickly. On yesterday,
Amen.
We went out in the community. We prayed for our brothers and sisters.
Thank
we
you.
Evangelized
the James
in our community.
Thank y'all so much and this morning.
Thank
Amen.
All those who
Sister
went out.
Frank,
the James,
thank y'all.
The Franks.
Thank
now,
you.
What I want to do at this time is, as we are honoring those, for matter of fact, you went out yesterday, stand. You went out yesterday,
Amen.
stand.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Thank
Hallelujah.
You. Thank you.
Thank y'all for being a part of the evangelism. Amen. Because it takes that part too in the mighty name of Jesus. And then to be a blessing to those. We didn't just go knock on their door and invite them. Amen. But we took out the time to tell them if you had a prayer request, a prayer need. So thank
yes,
y'all.
Thank you. Thank,
thank
you.
Thank y'all. Thank
and
y'all this
every,
morning.
Everyone who had a prayer request, we stopped. And we joined together in prayer. We said, we're going to pray for you later. No, we did it on the spot because
Amen.
We love people. Let's all stand. Let's all stand. We're getting ready to be ministered and sown. The blood still works. And while we're getting ready to do that, I want you to start preparing your hearts. Deacons,
Hallelujah.
Trustees, start coming now at this time. I need you to start. Give me the black folder, please, Parker. I need you to start coming at this time. Listen, this is the
Thank
last
you,
Sunday
God.
Of March.
Thank you, Lord.
So today, we want to make sure we honor
it's
God
resurrection
on this resurrection
Sunday.
Sunday.
Y'all.
Yeah, y'all pay attention, please. We want to make sure we honor God on this resurrection Sunday with our
yes.
seed. There are two ways we give here. The first way we give is through our green envelope. Our green envelope, that represents our building note. And this is the last Sunday of this month to make sure our building note for March is covered. Right now, we need $7,500 in the green envelope this morning to cover March's note. That's 75 of us is sowing $100 in the green envelope. You can sow online by texting 77977, Greenhouse All Caps. You can sow in the back electronically. You can grab a green envelope and bring it down the aisle. But I'm going to make sure that we get to our goal this morning. We need, it's not a goal, it's the bill that's due, $7,500. So I know y'all don't like it, but Pat's going to keep sowing. So I'm going to sow $1,000 seed towards the building. No, Deacon Carter, take this, please. So now we need $6,500 to go toward the building note of March.
Yes.
So I need now 65 of you to sow a seed of at least $100
Amen.
To the building note. Then all of us can participate in grace giving. That's our tithe and offering.
Yes.
Our tithe is giving God back 10% of what God has blessed you with. Can you imagine God says, I'm going to give you 100%.
Hallelujah.
You give me back 10. Then I'm going to bless the 90% of your life. That is a favor of God. And all of us
Thank
should be
God.
Giving in the white envelope.
Yes.
That's your tithe and that's your offering. There's no amount I can tell you to give. You give me because you are a cheerful giver. You give me because you love the Lord, and you give me because you want God to bless your life exponentially. You want God to grow you spiritually, financially, numerically. We'll never beg. We'll never prompt you to give because you want to give because you're giving back to a God that gave you it all. So get those seeds together, that green envelope. Let's exceed our $7,500, the white envelope, our tithes and offering, and the blood still works. That's why we give, because the blood still works.
Hey, everybody
say, start bringing your seed
the
now.
Blood
start bringing your seed
everybody
now.
You work.
come on, come on, come on. Before we pray over this morning's worship through giving portion, I want to read this real quickly. We got a praise report from one of the young men that's recently coming to the church. He started out by working at one of the political projects at the church. And he worked at a couple of the things we did outside the church. He sent me this report. He says, Pastor, I was selected to receive the Uplift Program $500 a month for 18 months. I want to thank you for all you do and for all your prayers. I'm not going to And he is one of several people that have came back to tell us thank you because they are receiving $500 a month for 18 months because of God allowing us to partner with Harris County. Give God praise for favor. Give God praise for favor. And if you came early, you saw a few police, Houston Police Department cars outside. They came by to say, Pastor, we want to just drop by today and tell you thank you for all you and that church does to make this community safe. So we didn't come up in order to be able to tell you thank you. I was awestruck by law enforcement coming by the church on Easter Sunday to say thank you. Give God praise. Give God praise. I just want you to know that every time you sow a seed in the green envelope to keep these doors open, you're changing lives. It's not just so we can have a building. No, we're building and rebuilding and restoring lives. There are families that were messed up from the floor up, and because they were able to come through those doors, they're now standing up. There are men and women who have stories of suicide or homicide and all kinds of sides, but now they found that Jesus was on their side, and now they're on the pathway to victory because of those seeds. Your tithes allow ministry to take place. Your building allows there to be a building, a place, a tabernacle for ministry to take place. It's not just preaching and singing songs, but changing lives 7 days a week. So I just want to tell you thank you for your seed. And if you have not sown yet, you can sow in the back electronically. You can text 77977 Greenhouse, all caps. If you don't have your building note right now, you can text me and I'll meet you later. Because we're going to make sure on Monday morning that Trina's able to go to the bank and give them what we need to give them so they won't come to us. Amen? Amen. Let us pray over this morning, see. Stand on your feet and let's receive Gap God's anointed praise dance ministry as they come to bless us in the spirit of dance. Come on, stand on your feet and receive God's anointed praise dance ministry. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Bless them, bless them. Bless the visionary and Sister Bridget Williams. Bless her for her vision. And bless all those that are serving this morning.
It's a because of all that you brought me through. And everything I survive is all because of you. I'm grateful for
Sherelle. As the praise team comes back for one more selection, I want to publicly, was it last year or the year before last when you were injured praise dancing? Last year on Easter, right? Last year on Easter, she had an injury while ministering in church that required surgery. She kept ministering in pain and did not stop. And then there's a void that took place in our children's church, kids 12 and under. She came to me and said, Pastor, you know, when I'm not in church, I'm working at a daycare. And she said, I will be willing to work in G-Force Children's Church. And she stepped up to the plate and has not, listen, she is focused and faithful. And I want the public to tell you, thank you. How old are you?
20.
A 20-year-old who says, I want to serve God and I want to use the gift that God gave me to serve. And she's never asked for a dime. And she just says, let me do my thing, Pastor. And I promise you, you'll never be embarrassed or you'll never regret giving me this opportunity. So I just want to publicly say thank you and I love you. Bless you. Bless you. Let's now minister through this final song, Grateful, and then I will give you my Easter speech. Y'all pray for me. Cool, Pastor, don't fuss at me this evening. I tried to put some structure in place on Easter, and it's Sherelle's fault, and it was Bridget's fault, not mine. Well, if y'all only knew the backdrop story of what's going on with me right now, y'all would be like, why don't you just shut up? But I'm grateful. Man, I'm grateful. Y'all got it? Y'all need me to sing? Y'all got it? Y'all got it?
Come on, just lift your hands if you're grateful all over the building. Come on, just tell God thank you. Hallelujah. I'm grateful for all of the things you've done for me. You've been faithful and merciful. For my sins you forgave me. Hallelujah. I will sing to you all the glory. I will give to you. I could never praise you enough. I'm grateful for all of the things you've done for me. You've been faithful and merciful. For my sins you forgave me. Hallelujah. I will sing to you all the glory. I will give to you. I could never praise you enough. Oh, can you help me say that? Oh, come on, one note. I'm grateful. Come on, everybody say it.
Everybody say, oh, one note. Oh, oh, hey, oh, come on. I'm grateful.
I'm grateful.
One more time. Everybody say, oh, one more time. Everybody say, oh, I'm grateful. Come on, will you lift your voice one more time? Everybody say, say you've been good to me. Say you've been good to me. In spite of what's going on.
Good to me.
Come on. Say you woke me up this morning. Started me on my way.
Hey, to me.
You've been the hands of protection. Hey. You've been the mighty one. You've been good. Hey. I wish I had a witness. Say you've been good to me. Say hi. Say hi. I will sing to you I will sing to you all the glory, and I'm going to give you all the praise I could never praise you enough. Now, if you're grateful, open up your mouth. I said, if you're grateful, open up your mouth. Only for those who's grateful. Open up your mouth and give them glory. Come on, shout like you know it.
Let's stand on our shout feet all like over the building. Stand on your feet all over the building.
Hallelujah.
Come on, stand on your feet all over the building. All the grateful people, stand on your feet all over the building. Yes, I'm grateful, I'm grateful, I'm grateful. Shout that one more time, Jamal, because I'm grateful. Let it resonate across this auditorium, across this sanctuary, in this green room. I'm grateful, I'm grateful. If you're grateful, give God a shout of praise in this place. Yes, indeed. I love sharing good news. I'm going to share one more thing real quickly, and then we're going to go into this morning's message. Where that first lady at? She know I got some issues. She need to get close. Oh, yeah. Now, I want to read this real quickly. I received this morning. Then we'll go right into the Word of God. It is 11-something, and we'll be out of here by 3-something. That was a joke, y'all. Joke, joke. Laugh, laugh, laugh. I got this message this morning. Happy Easter. He is risen. Heart, heart, heart. At Greenhouse International Church, my 3 grandsons... first Easter program. I'm so proud of my daughter for giving her life to Jesus and making sure her children have relationship with Jesus as well. God is able. A grandmother's prayers have been answered, Sister Bridget. Come on, give God praise. And that's what it's all about. I want to make sure this church has a reputation, not just feeding and clothing and providing, but creating a spiritual foundation for families to be restored, renewed, and rebuilt. And we're going to conquer all the evils that come against our children. This is more about our children moving forward than about us. Because we got to get right so our children can be right. Amen? Amen. Now stand with me, if you will. Let's get ready to get into this Word of God. While you're standing, turn your Bibles to the book of Luke, chapter 24. The book of Luke, chapter 24. I'm going to run through this as fast and as quickly as I possibly can without cheating you of an opportunity to be empowered and to be blessed. I want, again, because I am a people's person and I'm a paw, I want to wish publicly my little grandbaby Genesis, her 7th birthday was on this week, and tell Genesis happy, happy birthday. And her birthday is very significant because she shared the name of the little girl that this church was founded after, Genesis LeVay, my daughter, who you all, or most of you know, only lived 21 days, but those 21 days impacted my life forever. And I can now like Easter again. I hated Easter for a long time, because Easter was the Sunday my little girl was supposed to come to church to hear her daddy preach for the first time. And she died the week of Easter. So I give God praise for strength on this morning. And then, Deputy Raven, happy birthday to you on today. You at church on your birthday. Thank God for progress. Amen, amen. Shout happy birthday to the cop somewhere running around here. Church on her birthday. She burnt up already? Oh, okay, good deal, good deal. God bless you, God bless you. That was kind of weak. Y'all say happy birthday, say happy birthday. Now your Bibles, I did all that to get to this point. Your Bibles is now at Luke 24, verse 6 and 7. He is not here, he has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the 3rd day be raised again. Before you take your seats, I want to drill a few things home. My fate, your fate, our fate must be built on the fact we believe he was born out of a virgin mother. He died on a rugged cross. He was buried in a borrowed grave or tomb and got up on the third day with all power in his hands, and those hands connected us with him. If you don't believe that, you're wasting your Holy Ghost time. I want to ask the media team to put up this picture of a puzzle. We are able to find and locate last minute a picture of a puzzle. Before you take your seats, I want to demonstrate something to you. If you were ever going to solve a jigsaw puzzle, there are five ingredients in the center, which I just read you. That's the centerpiece. The centerpiece is what connects everything, and then you find the four cornerstones that will allow you to put all. When you ever did a puzzle, you see pieces everywhere. Well, once you find the centerpiece, which is the fact that he was born through a virgin birth, the fact that he hung on a rugged cross, the fact he went to a borrowed tomb, and the fact he got up on the third day, that's my centerpiece. And then there are some connecting things like my faith that will connect me to my centerpiece, and I can solve this puzzle of life. But if I don't have the centerpiece, everything else will be forced, and we won't have joy. So while you're standing, let's make these confessions together and remain standing, unless you cannot physically stand. This is my Bible, and today I declare it to be my final authority. I can do what it says I can do. I can be what it says I can be. On today, I will use my Bible to grow my faith and experience God through grace giving. One more verse before you take your seats. I want to just share the word today. Jeremiah 29 and 11. Jeremiah 29 and 11. I pray that I don't go viral today. Jeremiah 29 and 11. For I, and God is talking. This is declares the Lord. This is not EA, this is God. For I know the plans I have for you. Point to yourself. So these plans that God talking about, these plans God is describing, they're for me. Yeah. I don't care what you say about me, God has some plans for me. I don't care what I've been through, God has some plans for me. I don't care what I'm going through, God has some plans for me. I don't care what it looks like right now. It may look like I'm losing. It may look like I'm defeated. It may look like I'm in a mess right now. But I want you to know, God has some plans for me. Declares the Lord. And then he says, plans to prosper you and not harm you. So if it looks like you're being harmed right now, that's not God's plans. God's plans are to prosper you. So if you're going through a harming season, hold on, it's not over yet. And then it says, comma, pause, plans to give you hope and a future. Take your seats, hope and a future. Hope and a future. Park, if you don't mind, keep the red cup close by. Let me teach for a few minutes, and then we're going to have a celebration. But my goal today is not to be churchy. My goal today is to set the captives free. So you won't be bamboozled thinking this stuff don't work for you. In the book of Genesis, Adam and Eve were living out the plan God had for their lives. They were shot callers. They were bosses. They were kings and queens. They were him and her. They had it going on. In Greek, the word zoe means the God kind of life. And they were living the God kind of life. They had everything they wanted and needed. Can you imagine waking up every day knowing you have at your disposal everything you want and need at the same time. You have no shortcomings, no insufficiencies. You have no worries, no cares. Life is just life. But they messed up. They made some bad decisions. Okay, I know you gotta disconnect from me right now because you're not bold to say this yet, but I'm very transparent. As I told the men on yesterday, you can say anything about me that you know about me because I'm a public figure, but more importantly, I am a billboard for God. I want you to know every time I mess up, you can know how good God is to me. So you can say this, but I am not a victim. I am a survivor of my mess ups. See, you can't be real with yourself because you don't want nobody. Well, I've been a little perfect church saint all my life. The devil is a lie. You know good and well you lying, not telling the truth. You sing in the choir, not what you was drunk last Friday. You a deacon, a missionary, or this or that in church. You preaching, but you know everything you preaching and singing about and serving about. You ain't all about. Just let me tell you, I want you to just drop that in there for you holy saints. Who don't have a hell to send nobody to, nor a heaven to keep nobody out of. So Adam and Eve, they messed up. They made some bad decisions. So I'm talking today to the people who have made some bad decisions. And those bad decisions gave birth to suffering, hardships, and complications. So if we are dealing today with suffering, hardships, and complications, you can go back to Adam and Eve's bad decisions, but stop blaming Adam and Eve because you made your own series of bad decisions. Stop blaming your mama and your daddy. Stop blaming your baby daddy. Stop blaming them, white folks, brown folks, any folks. You look in the mirror and take accountability and responsibility because God had plans for you. And in Jeremiah 29, it does not say, I have plans for them. He says, I have plans for you. You let them work out their stuff, and you work out your stuff. Sin became a part of our lives, and guess what? Sin is out to win. Sin is out. Sin don't want you to win. In the Old Testament, they brought animal sacrifices to the altar, blood sacrifices to the altar, to be forgiven of their sins. But I want you to know, for this little kid from Fear Ford, the blood of animals was not enough to get us back on track to God's original plan for our life. You can bring the goat, the pig, the lamb, and everything else, and it still would not have been enough to get me back to my right frame of mind. I needed a relationship with a God that loved me unconditionally. I needed to know if I was broke, or if I was on top, if I was down, or if I was out, if I was on the top of the mountain, the bottom of the valley, that there was a God that loves me, sees me, and cares about me. And my dog, my cat, and my mule did not have enough blood that was strong to get me back into place of living the Zoro life, the God kind of life. I want to be where Adam and Eve was at, where I have no needs, I have no wants, and everything I need and want is already worked out. So God demonstrates grace giving. You don't have to stand, but just walk through this. Turn your Bible to John 3, 16 and 17. John 3, 16 and 17. I'm reading now from the Amplified Bible. For God so greatly loved and dearly prized the world that he even gave his one and only begotten Son, so that whoever believes and trusts in him as Savior shall not perish, but have eternal life. We all know that one. But many churches stopped at 16, didn't tell you 17. For God did not send the Son, Jesus, Mary's baby, a bridge over troubled waters, a doctor to the sick, lawyer to those in trouble, a mind regulator, did not come into the world to judge and condemn the world. I don't know where the church got this audacity that we are now judge and jury of the world, and it's our job to condemn folks and put folks in hell and to point finger at folks and put folks down. And Jesus did not come for that. So why is the church that was built upon this rock of Jesus, why is the church that's supposed to be filled with Christians, people who are Christ-like, why are you acting so un-Christ? I'm not talking about your drinking, your smoking. I'm talking about your unrighteousness, where you are judging and condemning folks for the same hell God brought you out of. But Jesus came that the world might be saved through him. So are you practicing condemnation? Jesus came practicing salvation. And can I be, tell me, be real transparent? I'm going to get some letters about this. We're going to frown up. Most of the people who are most judgmental and always talking about sending somebody to hell and condemning folks, they are the ones who are stuck in secret sins, and they're trying to cover their secret sins up by keep exposing your public sins. Be careful about folks who are always telling you somebody else is bad, because they really want you to discover they're bad, so they highlight somebody else is bad so you never get to their bad. So the next time they bring you a bone or bring you God, say, well, let's talk about you for a minute first. That'll end a lot of conversations. And just know, if you sit at the table of gossip, when you leave, you become the meal. So let's define grace. Grace giving. Let's define grace. An accurate common definition describes grace as the unmerited favor of God toward men. You didn't earn it. You don't even deserve it. But God. Woo! Okay, I gotta contain myself. But when I think about the goodness of God, I don't deserve this. I can't work into this. My mama and my daddy couldn't give me this. This grace I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it from me. That's why I scream. That's why I shout. That's why I give. That's why I serve. That's why I love us. The grace of God. We were evangelized yesterday, and we pulled up on a block. He knows some guys on the block, on the corner, slanging and banging and doing what they're doing right now. I say right now. And he said, can we go over there and pray with them? I said, sure, watch this. We pulled up, the window rolled down, and every guy that said, what's up, Pastor? They ain't came to church yet, but I'm their pastor. And watch this. In the midst of them doing what they're doing, selling what they're selling, I say, when we get ready to leave, we're going to pray first. When we get ready to leave, I'm going to give y'all these flyers, and while y'all doing what y'all doing, do this too. They said, yes, sir, we'll do whatever you ask us to do. The people that called me were looking like, what the world just happened? Because I understand we're not for the grace of God. I'm never too far removed from my yesterday to forget about my yesterday. If it were not for the grace of God, somebody would be praying for me somewhere. Okay, y'all can't handle all that. Okay. So, it's the unmerited favor of God towards man and woman. Okay. In the Old Testament, the term that's most often translated grace is hen. The New Testament is Shabbos. The term hen occurs often in the phrase favor in God's sight or in the eyes of the Lord. Oh, y'all missed that. I want favor in God's sight. I want to be in the eyes of the Lord. Because if I'm in the eyes of the Lord, he sees me at all times. And if I'm in the favor of the Lord, when he sees me, he's already worked it out for me. I just got to go through the process. Somebody say, trust the process. I got to go through the process because I'm in God's eyesight and I'm in God's favor. I don't care what you say or they say. I want God's eyes on me. So that means that God is a watchful master or king. And he's a master king with the one who finds favor. And who's finding favor? A servant, an employee, or a soldier, or a child of God. So if you are a child of God, can you stand real quickly with me, real quickly? If you consider yourself to be a child of God, not the child of Satan, not the child of a devil, all of that, it sounds real fancy to say, I was raised by wolves and all that. But if you are a child of God, you are in position and line for the eyes of the Lord to be upon you and the favor of God to be with you. So can you give God some thank you, hallelujah, I'm grateful, praise, that no matter what I've been through, no matter what I'm going through, no matter what I'm dealing with, I'm in the eyes of God, and I got the favor of God on my life. And because the favor of God is on my life, tell your neighbor, I hate to say tell your neighbor, but tell your neighbor, everything gonna be all right. Let's give God praise for the new musician and the guy on the instruments. But I'm not really rap tight, so help me today because I'm having some dental issues. And if you keep doing that, I'm gonna go crazy and something crazy might happen. So help me because I'm not rap tight. So while you're standing, you're already standing. Turn your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10. Well, you're already standing, so I ain't going to ask you to stand. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10. I'm trying to get us out of here, y'all. 1 Corinthians 15 and 10. I'm reading out from the Amplified Bible. But by the remarkable grace of God, I am... Ooh. But by the remarkable grace of God, I am what I am. It's no coincidence. It's not by happenstance. You are who you are by the remarkable grace of God. You're standing this morning in spite of all the hell you went through, going through, or been through because of the remarkable grace of God. Don't trip. You ain't that strong. It's the remarkable grace of God that got you in your right mind. Don't go too low when they talk bad about you, but don't get too high when they talk good about you, because there ain't nothing really about you. You are who you are and where you are and what you are because of the remarkable grace of God, because God got his eyes on you and God got his favor on you. You're still standing. Okay, back to the text. I'm sorry, I get too excited. But by the remarkable grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not without effect. In fact, I worked harder than all the apostles. Though it was not I, get this, woo! Though it was not I. Well, every time y'all say, Pastor, you work real hard. Let me bust your bubble. It's not really about me. It's about God. Every time you see me praying for somebody or feeding somebody or encouraging somebody or helping somebody, it ain't always what I want to do. But because of the remarkable grace of God, I got to keep on going. Because if I turn my back on God, I'm afraid that God. And I don't know about you, but I owe God. Is there anybody here? And your testimony is, I owe God. Okay. So though it was not I, but the grace of God, his unmerited favor and blessing, which was or is with me. Take your seats. Grace in the New Testament is largely encompassed by the word Shara. The parable of the prodigal son is the most obvious example, because in that parable, it is extended grace to one who on no basis of himself should be shown grace other than his relationship with his father. So if you're not familiar with the story of the prodigal son, let me bring you a speed real quickly. There was a boy who was being raised in a very wealthy, good house, and he went to his pops and said, "Dad, I want to go and explore the world for myself. I don't like these rules, this house no more. You're too strict. You understand. Parents just don't understand." He had that kind of mindset. So he left the house, but his daddy blessed him with some dinero, some money, some fortune, put it in his pocket and put it on his cash app and on his Zelle and said, "Now, son, go figure it out for yourself." The boy left the house and went popping bottles. The boy went having a party. The boy went to like Eddie Murphy, party all the time, party all the time. And the boy was the talk of the town because every Friday night, happy hour was on him. Well, he didn't know the trick was on him, too, because one day he put his credit card out and they swiped and said decline. All the money was gone and all the groupies and friends was gone too. So now this boy found himself in a hog's pen. You got to understand something. Where he was from, being a hog pen was despisable, and he had got to the lowest of the lowest. Now this boy is the lowest of the lowest. It's like he woke up in a frat house. He woke up in a bad place under the bridge somewhere. He woke up sleeping outside the church, but that was not the plan God had for him. He woke up in a jail cell. He woke up in rehab. You get the picture, right? She woke up in another man's bed that was not her husband. You get the picture, right? He woke up somewhere that he did not deserve to be there. So he looked and said, "In my father's house." But because he messed up so bad, the people at his father's house, he didn't know how they were going to receive him. The word hate is a strong word, but you know what I hate one of the most in my life? It's church folks who condemn folks, judge folks, and criticize folks, and run folks out of my father's house. Girl, this ain't your church. It's God's church. You have no right to... If I go on North Broadway and get the prostitute and drug in the gangbang, say, "Sit up here, down there, sit up here," that ain't none of your business. It ain't your house. Jesus came to save, not to condemn. So he wonders, how am I going to get back? And how he got back was through God's amazing grace. Oh, if I had time right now, I posed the question, how many of you were once upon a time out of your mind, a messed up place, in a low place, and you didn't deserve to be welcomed back home, but yet somehow, God's remarkable grace found you, and God's grace got you back on your feet, and you start walking back toward your father's house, not knowing how they were going to treat you, not knowing how the father was going to treat you, or how the folks in the house were going to treat you, but the Bible says the father, from a long ways off, he kept looking for his son. Remember, the eyes of the Father is on you. And don't get it twisted. I'm sure the Father got a report of how bad his son was doing. I'm sure some church folks who was popping bottles on Friday, but seeing the crowd on Sunday, went and told him that, "You know, I saw Ray Ray at the club last night." But the thing about when you say you saw somebody somewhere, you know you dry stitching on yourself too, because to see them there meant you was there. So the prodigal son is a perfect example of the grace, remarkable grace of God. Because we don't deserve it. The only way we can get it is just by simply being in a relationship with our Father. So Paul also sometimes mentions the gift of grace from God. Turn your Bibles to Romans 15 and 15. You understand, but you can if you want to. I can't see your hair if you don't stand now. Romans 15 and 15. We're going to read 15 and 16. "Still, on some points, I have written to you very boldly and without reservation to remind you about them again. Because of the grace," Paul is the master teacher, preacher, apostle. Paul says, "because of the grace that was given to me from God." Man, I'm doing this because grace. I've been graced to do this. On my own, I could not handle this assignment. I've been graced for this assignment. I was graced at my mother's birth canal to one day land on Greens Road in Greens Guns Point to change the narrative. My whole life preparing me for the season that I'm graced to do. But you also have a season that God has graced you to do. You just got to find it. So Paul says, this grace was given to me to be a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles. For those who know, Gentiles were the bad boogers. The Gentiles were not the ones who had it going on, was doing all the right things, two-parent homes and the gated community and educated, divine nine. Now, those were not the Gentiles. Gentiles were the ones who was, yeah. The ones who was out there. The ones who would knock your head off for looking at them the wrong way. The ones who you step on their white sneakers and they might take your life. The Gentiles, the ones who were banging and slanging and doing other. The Gentiles were the ones who had not yet discovered who they were yet, the original plan that God had for their lives. But don't be too hard on a Gentile because your pastor is a Gentile. Y'all so fake and phony. And I'm preaching to Gentiles. Y'all be bugging me out, boy. You're saved, so sanctified and holy all your life. Your boo-boo probably even steam. You a baby, your boo-boo smells good. Come on, child. I minister as a priest of the gospel of God in order that my offering of the Gentiles may become acceptable to him, sanctified, made holy, and set apart for his purpose by the Holy Spirit. So if everybody already got together, there would be no need for the ministry. If everybody got their act together in their right mind, if ain't nobody tripping, if ain't nobody on that stuff, if ain't nobody making bad decisions, if everybody is in their right mind, there's no dysfunction, there's no mental illness, there's no drug addiction, there's no this or that, there's no cheating and scheming, there's no this or that, then what will we need the church for? What will we need the gospel for? We need the gospel so the gospel can get people back on the right track to get back in God's plan. So stop judging and critiquing and criticizing and use the grace on your life to get somebody else out of their prodigal situation. So grace then is the power that human beings receive to perform his or her gifted task. Okay. Somebody shout, my gift will make room for me. Well, y'all know when to shout. God gave you a gift, and then God graced that gift so you can be good at that gift, and that gift gonna make room for you. Okay. In here, from the White House to Austin to City Hall, every leader in this country, name and personal number is in this phone. Not because of who I am, but I've been graced by God, and my gift that God graced has made room for me in every place. But I'm no different than you. If you allow the grace on your gift to be exposed, then God will expose your name behind every door you belong behind. And every door that I'm in now, I don't deserve to be there. I don't have the credentials to be there, but I've been graced to be there. I wish I had somebody's voice say, I'm there because of grace. So turn your Bibles the most dominant metaphor of grace you can find in Romans 3 and 23, where grace becomes a legal metaphor of justification. Paul says it in Romans 3 and 23. Since all, okay, let me start over. Y'all didn't get it. Since all, okay, still didn't get it. Since the pastor and the pastor's wife and the pastor's children and the pastor's grandchildren and anybody who likes the pastor have sinned, That's what it say, right? Since all, A-L-L, since all have sinned, and Paul says, continually fall short of the glory of God, and are being justified, declared free of the guilt of sin, made acceptable to God, and granted eternal life as a gift by his precious undeserved grace through the redemption, the payment of our sin, which is provided in Jesus Christ. Jesus already paid the price. Why are you tripping? You missed that. You should have been shouting right there. If Jesus already paid the price, why are you tripping? What's it going to cost? What's it going to cost is God's remarkable grace. What's it going to cost is God's unconditional love. Don't worry about what they say, what they think. You know you got God's grace, so keep it moving. All have sinned. So we're justified freely by the grace of Jesus. He paid the price. Okay. Raven, go in the foyer area real quick. In that area. Go out there real quickly. Can you hear my voice? Go out there real quickly. Now holler real loud, your cop voice. Say, Pastor, let me in. Say it loud, Raven. Say, Pastor, let me in. Come on in. Now say it again. Why are you asking me to come in when I've already granted permission to come in? Let's do one more time for the slow learners. Go back outside. And scream real loud, Pastor! Scream real loud, Pastor! Let me in! Come on in, I already paid the note. Holler one more time, Pastor! Let me in. Who in their right mind gonna keep asking permission to come in when you're already in grand permission to come in? And what am I saying is, why are you struggling with your past when Jesus already paid the price for your past? Jesus says, come on in, my son. Come on in, my daughter. I've already taken care of that. Stop letting folks kick you outside when the inside don't belong to them. You already been given. Come in! Because nobody in here is without sin to stop you from coming in. Okay. See, the unmerited favor of God buys us legal freedom from sin and cancels the sentence of guilt the judge had to declare. Okay. I'll never forget. I went to court one time with a young lady, and she had 7 or 8 violations of her conditions. And I was sitting in court, and when she went up before the judge, she asked the judge, can my pastor come? And the judge would say, yeah, your pastor? She said, yes, sir, with her head down. Judge said, Pastor, that's your member? I said, yes, sir. Take him. She said, judge, if that's your pastor, go. And she walked out of court guilty, but forgiven. The grace on my life connected her to the grace of the courts, and she walked out free. Not because she deserves to walk out, but God's remarkable. Y'all don't know when to shout. Y'all don't know when to shout. If that was your daughter, if that was your son, if that was you or your mama or your brother, them, you would be saying, God, thank you. Funny story. Young man got pulled over, 45, put him over in the parking lot at Walmart, 45 West Road. And cops ran to his car and drew guns, all that. Sent back for his insurance and license. The kid had a church flyer in the dashboard. That's a different one. A church in the dashboard. He had a church flyer. The cop looks at him. What you doing with that? He says, the church I go to. Oh, Pastor, check with your pastor. Put your seatbelt on, drive safe, gone. He called me saying, Pastor, I don't know what just happened. Yeah. I was speeding. And I forgot to renew my insurance. I thought they were about to take me. They saw the flyer from church. They go. Remarkable grace. We got to get ready to go. What my wife referring to, that was a young man, and he's now a professional comedian all over the country. He's well known, but when he was just coming up, he had some tickets, unpaid tickets, and he had his first big performance that weekend. It was a Thursday. Cops pulled him over on Bama North Houston, put him to the Walgreens, and they handcuffed him, put him back in the police car. He asked for one favor. He said, can I call my pastor to pick my car up because I won't be able to afford to get it out of impound? The cop said, if he answer, we'll do that. He called me. I just happened to be in a position where I could answer. I went to the scene. But before I got there, young man, when I got there, I came out. I had a church flyer, a tithe envelope, and all that stuff in my hand. I walked to the cops and said, if you will release him to me right now, I'll go and pay all his tickets because his life is ready to change the weekend. And I can't have him locked up. We go get ready to set him up. The cop said, Pastor, if you bold enough to ask me to unhandcuff this boy, take him out the back seat of my car, and take him, let you go take care of his business, if you crazy ask me that, I'm crazy to let him go. Young man, get out. Now he's one of the most famous comedians in America. Unmerited favor. Thank you for reminding me of that. Let's all stand. Let's go. I know y'all got it. Let's go. I made it. I'm going to read this one. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I was through. I got five more pages. I thought I was through. My bad. Sad anyway. Romans 3 and 26. Slide. Let me see what time it is. Okay. Romans 3 and 26. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where then is the boasting? Thank you, Holy Spirit. Those testimonies I just gave you, that I wasn't boasting. Paul says, where then is the boasting? It is excluded because of what law? The law that requires work? No, because the law that requires faith. I was able to share with you a series of testimonies how God used me to bless others to set them free, not because of who I am, but because of the grace of the assignment. So I'm not boasting nor bragging. I'm declaring to you because of the grace of God, which I don't deserve, God uses me in unusual ways because of the grace of God. Not because I'm the E or the A or the D. He uses me because of the grace of God. So don't trip whenever I say what I'm giving in the offering. I couldn't always do that, but I've been graced by God to do that. I haven't always been who I am right now, but I've been graced by God to be who I am. But it does not stop with me. You too can do what I do if you let the grace of God on your life dominate and dictate your life. See, grace is free and not by the work of man. So stop trying to please folks. Even suffering is connected to the grace that God has given us. While you're still standing in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7, I'm almost done. 2 Corinthians 12. Verse 7, Amplified, but I'm going to just read it straight through. A thorn in the flesh. Paul says, because of the surpassing greatness and extraordinary nature of the revelations which was placed from God, for this reason to keep me from thinking of myself as too important or too high. See, some of you think too highly of yourself. That's why you keep going through hell. You think too highly of yourself. But I tell you, Bridget, God got a strange sense of humor. Whenever I start reading too many press clippings about who I think I am, God said, okay, let me show you something. I'm going to be real transparent. I know y'all, my granddaughter going to be so mad at me. Yeah, I'm having some dental issues. I went to the dentist on Monday, twice on Friday, and yesterday, and my teeth still, and it's a high possibility that while I was preaching, my teeth would have fell out of my mouth. My grandson said, Papa, you going viral today, but I'm about to be through preaching, right? They still in my mouth. Thank God, thank God, thank God. But every time I think of all that, God remind me, boy, no, you're not. Sit down and shut up somewhere. Can you imagine Pretty Eddie walking around with his... See, God will do this. God will say, shut up! Sit down! Humble yourself. So back to the text. Back, I had to be real transparent with you for you to understand something. It applies for all of us. Don't think so highly of yourself. For this reason, I think too highly of myself. God put a thorn. Not the devil. Get this too. The devil did not do this. The devil did not affect my sight. The devil is not now affecting my gentle. The devil has nothing to do between me and God. God placed a thorn in the flesh, which was given to me, a messenger of Satan to torment and harass me, to keep me from exalting myself. See, God will use the devil so he can use you. Concerning this, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times. One for the Father, one for the Son, and one for the Holy Ghost. Paul thought he got real churchy to work. That church stuff don't work all the time. You need some God stuff. But Paul says, I prayed 3 times that this would leave me alone. But God said to me, my grace, I didn't told him now so we can just go crazy. If it happened, it just happened. My grace, my remarkable grace, my unconditional grace, my agape grace, my supercalifragilisticexpialidocious grace is sufficient for you. My loving kindness and my mercy are more than enough, always available regardless of the situation. I know you messed up. My grace is sufficient. My power, says the Lord, is being perfected and it's completed and shows itself most effectively in your weakness. Get this, in your weakness, God shows out the most. Therefore, I will at all more gladly boast in my weakness. That's why I'm so transparent, because I don't want you acting like I'm some super God or something. I'm messed up from the flow up just like you. I'm just covered by God's remarkable grace. We go through stuff just like you. We just covered by God's remarkable grace. My children sometimes confuse me too, but we just covered by God's grace. Sometimes I wonder, God, why so much pain? But then I gotta say, but your grace is sufficient. That's what Paul says. If I boast in anything, I boast in my weakness. So the power of Christ may completely engulf me and enfold me and dwell in me. So verse 10, so I will well please with my weakness, with insults, with distresses, with persecutions. Hear me, brother, with persecutions and with difficulties for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak in human strength, then I am strong, truly able, truly powerful, truly growing from God's strength. Is there anybody here and you're glad you got God's strength? Anybody here, you're glad when they gave up on you, you had God's strength? Anybody felt like quitting and giving up? The load got too heavy, the road got too hard. Anybody ever cried themselves to sleep? Anybody ever wrote a suicide note? Anybody ever thought about suicide? Anybody ever thought about giving up and throwing in the towel? But yet someway, at your lowest moment, you were getting ready to pop the pills. You were getting ready to pull the trigger. You were getting ready to drive off the bridge. But yet someway, God kept you in your weakness, your found strength. I wish somebody could take about 3 seconds and tell God thank you for keeping me. Tell God thank you for strengthening me. Tell God thank you for not abandoning me. Is there anybody here and you can shout God thank you on Resurrection Sunday? You allowed the tomb to be empty. You allowed the bowl to be raised back, and you allowed Jesus to come out so I can come out of that mess I was going through and get back to the plan, to the plans God has for me. So when Paul says his grace is sufficient and my power is made in weakness, I gotta shout. I gotta shout. I gotta shout. While you're standing, peep this, 1 Peter 5 and 10, as we get ready to bounce out of here. And the God of all grace, not some grace, not many grace, but the God of all grace, who called you to the eternal glory in Christ, and after
after you have suffered a little while, after you have suffered a little while, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong and make you firm and make you steadfast. I told the men yesterday, every time you come to this church, I don't ever want you to come in just to come. Come with a purpose in mind. Come so you can be wiser and you can be stronger and you can get closer to God. Because if you get stronger and wiser and closer to God, then you'll know the revelation of God in your life, and you'll be the man that God called you to be in spite of anything you've gone through. If you get wiser and stronger and closer to God, you'll discover your purpose, and God will grace your purpose. Let's get ready to bounce here. Romans 6 and 14, for sin shall no longer win, for sin shall no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace. So I just dropped by to tell you, real quickly, as we get ready to leave. My past, my mistakes, my hookups, my hangups, my this, my that, I'm looking for it, but it's not there. What happened? What happened? Where's that? Where's that? He got up, and when he got up, and I gave him my hand, he took my stuff. He took my stuff out the tomb. He took my stuff out the grave. He took my stuff and threw it in the sea of forgetfulness. You can bring it up, but it's gone. You can bring it up, but it's been flushed down the Samoa. It's gone. Now my question is there anybody here that made their mind up? I'm wiser. I'm stronger. I'm closer to God. And from this day forward, sin will not win in my life, in my family, in my health, in my children, in my money, in my relationships, in my career, in my education, in my neighborhood. Wherever I go with Jesus, and his grace is sufficient. Everyone, please stand. Everyone, please stand. We're getting ready to leave. I want to do two more things as we go. We're getting ready to have what's called an altar call, which people are ready to come. Don't move yet. Hear my instructions. But before we release the altar for you to come, to get closer to Jesus, if you desire to give your life to Christ for the first time, we want to receive you here, a place with no judgment, no condemnation. If anybody point their finger at you, remind them there's four more fingers pointing back at them. You're in the right place to get what God has for you. So my first appeal will be, if you need Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, he's not on the cross nor on the tomb. He's in your life. And we want to put you in a position where you can receive him. Secondly, you're here and you desire for this church, this Greenhouse International Church, the place you're going to grow to reach your full potential. You're here and you desire for this church to become your church. In just a minute, we're going to ask you to start coming. Not yet, but just a minute. We want you to start coming. You're here and you desire for us to pray, not just for you, pray with you. Touch and agree that the grace of God will be with you. We're going to ask you to come. And then finally, you desire to get baptized.
for the first time as a prodigal son, for another time, we want you to come. As you're singing this song, we want you to come. You desire your salvation. Oh, come on, give God praise. Give God praise. Give God praise. Salvation to receive the plan of God for your life. For church membership, partnership. For this greenhouse to be your spot, your place. You come. You come for us to pray with you and for you. You come. And you come because you desire to get baptized in the month of May. You're going to have a community baptism in the month of May. You desire to get baptized. Come now. Come now. Come now. Just as you are. Come now.
Stretched him wide. He hung his head. For me, he died. That's love. That's love. The story is 3 days late. He rose again. That's love. That's love. Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. That's love. That's love. They hung him high, they stretched him wide. He hung his head, for me he died. That's love. That's love. But that's not how the story ends. 3 days later, he rose again. That's love. Anybody know that's love? Oh, oh, oh. I said Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. That's love. The story is 3 days later, he rose again. That's love. That's love. Oh, said Jesus went to Calvary to save the wretch like you. For they hung him high in his trust and wine. He hung his head for me. He died. That's love. I'm so glad you left me. Yes, you knew. I said Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you.
Let's all stand, please. Let's all stand. Let's give God praise for all those who came down these aisles for prayer, for baptismal, for church membership, for salvation. Let's give God praise for all of them. Let's remain standing as we get ready to close in prayer. Thank God for being a part of this Easter resurrection service. I pray that Cephas come up top. Pastor, just bring him up top. Bring Cephas up top. I pray that you will be back next Sunday and the Sunday after and the Sunday after. They're still coming. Come on, give God praise. They're still coming. We're not going to rush you. This is a very sacred service, take your time. Listen. I need everyone to extend their hands this direction for those who are at the altar being prayed for, those who are making decisions to become a part of God's kingdom first and then this church secondly. And just give God praise that their strength, these men will be strengthened and graced. These young ladies, these families, this young man will be restored. This young man over here will be able to walk in God's unmerited favor. Both those young men. And all those who decide that this church will be your church, make sure you don't leave without filling out your paperwork to a member of the greenhouse, a part of the greenhouse. We just want to love on you and love you unconditionally. Please, right now, no walking if you can afford. No walk. We're about to get ready to leave, but let's be very sacred right now. Let's be intentional as we get ready to leave. Let's be intentional. Let's be intentional to make sure everyone has a chance to receive what they came to receive. I'm asking you to stand right now. We get ready to close in prayer. On this cross, you see all the prayer requests that have been made, and we're going to have these posted here. And when your prayer request is granted, I want you to come and find it and bring it to me so we can celebrate together. But I also need you to do this. If you're here and you have a special prayer request and you want to tap into the grace on this house, I need you to grab a green envelope. Lower the music just for a second. I need you to grab a green envelope. You can sew online by texting 77977 green as our cap. You can sew in the back through all the electronic machines in the back. You can grab a green envelope and fill it out. Even if you fill out online, bring your green envelope, and on the back of your envelope, write what your prayer request is and give it to me in my hand. And every day until your request has been granted, I pray every day over every prayer request. And once your prayer is answered, I want you to come and take it off the cross. But I'm asking you right now to sow a seed and connect your seed to your prayer request. On the front of your envelope, write your information, your name, and what you gave, and all that stuff. I'm not telling you give some certain amount, but on the back, write what your prayer request is, and we're going to touch and agree that God's going to grant your request. Let's all remain standing as we get ready to close in prayer. So bring your seed, the covenant seed. This week, I need everyone. This week, we have no Tuesday night service this week. So I need everyone back on this Sunday at 9:30 for prayer. This Sunday at 9:30 for prayer. We pray from 9:30 to 10:30 on the first Sunday. And then we have worship service at 10:30, followed by communion, Lord's Supper. So everyone that's here today, come back next Sunday. Those 50 people who received the groceries, make sure you go and claim your groceries. Keep it for yourself or give it to someone else. All first-time guests, you can go shopping here. If you don't see anything here that you want as a first-time guest, leave me your name and number, because this week I'm going to be going crazy giving some away. I'm going to contact you with some other stuff that you can receive. And everyone who had a first-time guest, please make sure you go shopping also. Let's all stand. If you don't mind, grab somebody by the hand. If you don't mind, grab by the hand. I'm not forcing you to, but if you don't mind, grab somebody by the hand if you desire. We want to close this Resurrection Sunday out as one great big family. Coach Oliver Williams, come to the stage, please. We're getting ready to have a special prayer and a collective prayer for everyone. But this young man is standing on the stage. I want to make sure I gave the right. He's one of the top-ranked receivers in collegiate football. In less than 30 days, he'll be entering into the NFL draft. He's. This is what's remarkable, Sister Bridget. I know him, but I didn't know that was his mother. And I can show in my phone how, you know, I'm a fanatic of certain things, and I've been following his career. Boy, catch across the middle, two hands, eyes closed, and he's been a dog on the football field. Yeah. But I did not know that was your son. But I can show you. I just told you who. I told you your name, what position you play, what school you go to, and your ranking in wide receivers across the United States of America. Because athletes call me all the time for prayer, and you never called for prayer, but I've been praying for you anyway, just because I knew your story. but I know who your mother was. So I asked Coach Oliver, he's an athletic trainer, and for years we've been praying and covering for young men. He's going to put his hands on your back. And when you leave today, these men, these G men across this room, we not got your back. I love your family. Therefore, I love you. And I just told you history. And she ain't told me nothing. I didn't know. But God knew. So then I'm going to lay his hands on your back and and as a mother, she's going to be covering you as a mother. He's going to cover you as an athlete, but just not just an athlete, but a young man with purpose. That bullshit. You didn't give me permission, but I know you've had some financial complications. God's going to grace your son to put a smile on your face the devil cannot erase. And for matter of fact, every black man here come to the altar. Every man come to the altar. I gotta get it. Every man come to the altar. Every male come to the altar. Every male come to the altar. Quickly, quickly. Every male. Oh, look at this. Look at this. Y'all make sure we get this on camera. Look at this. Good God Almighty. Look at this. Look at all these men. Look, look. Look at this. Wow. 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 Look at this. Ooh-wee. Sisters, I'm loving this right here. Brother Prentice, Deacon Joe, let's Carter. Don't let any of these men leave without snatching them up. Make sure we got their name and phone number. We're going to recruit them to the army of the Lord. Remember I told y'all a vision I had. We're going to march down North Borough 100 men strong, and we're going to shut down every drug house, every house of prostitution. We're going to pick one Saturday, and the men of this church are going to shut it all down. This is the vision being unfolded. So we're getting ready to pray. Man, wow. Every mother, every grandmother, every big mama, every auntie, every community mama. This prayer we're going to pray is God confirming to you he heard your prayers. And your son will not die before his purpose has been fulfilled. We got to go. I know y'all ready to go. That's a young man. I came outside before church. I saw you outside. I came outside. I asked you not to leave without seeing me. Where are you? There's a young man. Did he leave? He left. Please give me his name and number. I'm going to go find him. It's hard sitting around church. It's a long time being in church. I don't like this either. Especially when you're new to this stuff. You be ready. The devil keeps saying, man, get out of there, get out of there. So I'm going to go find him. Before I go home, I'm going to find your son. Amen. So we're getting ready to pray. Bless your soldier. Bless your soldier. Wow.
You need the R, Pastor?
Yeah.
Thank you.
The first thing that I did, young man, and to all these men in this house, I washed his feet with water. Somebody washing away his past. Washing away every negative voice been spoken over him, about him, and to him. I just washed all the dirt away. When the prodigal son came home, his father first of all put a coat over him to hide all the stuff he's going through so negative church folks and family folks couldn't talk him out of his destiny. So when I just washed your feet with water, I just purified your future. And you would never walk back into anything that you had to walk out of. For matter of fact, you're so fast, you can run out of your mess. So I need you to make your mind that when you leave here, your 4.6 feet will run out of every negative situation. And you can call on these men to cover your back. I'm talking about an athletic future right now. I'm talking about the future of every man at this altar. Every man, as I wash this young man's feet, I'm washing your feet also symbolically. Therefore, I'm declaring I'm washing your past away. Because of God's remarkable grace, you're going to be all right. Because of God's remarkable grace, no weapon formed will prosper. No negative voice shall conquer. All that stuff been washed away. Now I'm going to anoint your feet with the oil. And when I anoint this young man's dog, I'm anointing every man, every family in this house with the oil. The oil is symbolic of the righteousness, the holiness, the pureness, the covenant connection between us, fallen, broken men, and God's remarkable grace. So when I place my hand on your feet, you get ready to walk into arenas you've dreamed about. You get into a walk away in a status you've craved. I am decreeing, declaring that on draft night, your status will change. And your mother's status will change. Before the contract even signed, God's already worked it out. And not just for an athlete, but for every man. They want to be a blessing to his family. So break generational curses. I decree and declare right now, in the name of Jesus, he is who you called him to be. And your remarkable grace will keep him and cover him. And you're going to use his story all across this nation to show other young men that if you stick with Jesus, everything will be all right. That if you run with Jesus, one day you'll hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Crown him right now. Shower him with favor right now. Let everything he's going through strengthen him, make him wiser, and draw him closer to you. Let him shine like never before. And let every man at this altar and every woman standing, let them stand knowing your amazing grace is sufficient. So we leave this place knowing we're in our winning season and nothing can stop us from being victorious. In Jesus' name, you are anointed and appointed for this time and this season. And every man in here is getting ready to win in this season. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. G-men, place your socks and shoes back on. And I pray, now men, put them back in this right position, put your socks and shoes back on, because that's how ministry works. Listen, don't forget next Sunday, 9:30 prayer, 10:30 worship, Monday through Friday at 7 a.m. we join the prayer line. Join tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. for prayer. God bless you. I love you. And may you have a wonderful, wonderful Easter.
God is able to do just what